thank you. Okay.
Sam, can you unmute the... Thanks.
Okay, I'm going to go on now with an example, a couple examples of how the enemy works in our minds through the teaching. Thank you. The enemy, of course, has limited resources. He is not infinite. He knows the Bible better than we do, and he knows he has no hope of his kingdom standing if ever the body of Christ grasps what is written in this book and actually does what it says. So he has elaborated a complex strategy over the centuries to teach us other things that we would not be able to enter into the authority of Jesus and take up the weapons of Jesus and to overthrow his kingdom once and for all. One of the first of his strategies, well, the first one, of course, is we talked about with Matt, is to corrupt the teaching. Send another teacher with a twisted version of the truth and lead them astray and out of the garden. Another huge strategy he has is passivity, which is why I teach on Cinderella a lot. So, Adriano, is that video already on YouTube, Cinderella? Okay. Adriano did an excellent job filming some of my teachings. Some of them are on YouTube, but some of them are not quite edited yet. Anyway, we're not going to do Cinderella this morning. So the enemy decided a long time ago to build up fortresses, to raise up fortresses of thinking against the knowledge of God. Paul warns the Corinthians about this. When he says our spiritual warfare is not carnal, it's really in the mind. Because we have to destroy, this is 2 Corinthians 10, verse 5, we destroy speculations and every lofty thing raised up against the knowledge of God, and we are taking every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. So if you've ever looked into the construction of fortresses or castles here in Europe or in Asia or wherever, you know that they are built up over the centuries, and they get bigger, and the walls are built out and fortified and thickened, and they just get more and more impressive, more and more dominating, these fortresses. And that's exactly what the enemy has done in Europe for 1,000 years, and then has used European structures, particularly the European university, to disciple all the nations of the earth. So this has been a whole process. There have been many layers. There are many, many walls to this fortress, and we won't go into that today, but I just want to mention a couple. One is a teaching that came into the church in the 12th century, I believe it was. I was there, but I can't remember that far back very easily. And it was at the University of Paris, at the Sorbonne, with a very influential teacher named Abelard. Abelard was an amazing guy. He was a very winsome teacher. He was one of the first in Europe to write about romantic love. That's another story. But anyway, many of the students there came from all over Europe because of his teaching gift. He was a priest of the church, and he reversed the centuries-old teaching of Augustine, which had taught us that we must believe in order to understand. In other words, faith comes before understanding. Abelard said, no, he got that wrong. It's the other way around. We have to understand in order to believe. And he completely switched it. And because of his influence and his teaching gift and because of the spiritual power he had in his disobedience, the church switched. And we made understanding the condition of believing God. And that was a first step toward the idolatry of the mind. We put our understanding first. And in later times, what immediately developed after that was we make our understanding conditional on our obedience. In other words, I'll obey what God's telling me to do if I understand it. And if I don't, I'm not going to do it. Because God's working is submitted to my reason. See, the temptation of the Pharisees is that God's power is submitted to me. The temptations of the Sadducees is God's working must be reasonable to me. We had an event here a few years ago that we called the Think Tank, named after the think tank in my garden. I always wanted to have a think tank, so I got one. I was so happy. And we were trying to dig into some epistemology, and we were starting with Descartes. And I was just asking God, I had to speak the next morning, and I had so little time to try to get across what this was about. And it had taken me years to work through it, and here I was expecting the people attending to work through it in a matter of a couple hours. So I knew I needed a miracle. And he just led me to a passage that we often meditate at Christmas time. It's Gabriel's announcement to Zacharias, the father of John the Baptist. This is in Luke chapter 1. I'd invite you to consider this with me. So Zacharias, as you know, he and his wife Elizabeth are very consecrated people. Verse 6 says of Luke 1, they are both righteous in the sight of God, walking blamelessly in all the commandments and requirements of the Lord. Pretty good recommendation. So Zacharias, it's his turn to enter the temple and burn incense. He's in there alone. He's standing next to the altar. And an angel of the Lord appears to him, verse 11, standing right by the altar of incense. And Zacharias was troubled and fear gripped him, which usually happens when you see an angel. And the angel said to him, as they usually do, "Do not be afraid, Zacharias." And he goes on to tell him, "Your prayer of 50 years, or however long, has been answered. And you are going to have a son. And not just any son. Many will rejoice at his birth. He'll be great in the sight of the Lord, drink no wine or liquor, and he will be filled with his Holy Spirit while yet in his mother's womb." Which, there are a lot of books about the Holy Spirit, but none explaining how that's going to happen again, because it didn't, apparently. And then it's very clear that Gabriel goes on to say he'll be moving in the spirit and power of Elijah to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. In other words, the Messiah. This is such an amazing announcement. And Zechariah says, "Well, I don't see how that's going to happen because I'm old and you should see my wife." And Gabriel gets furious with him and says, "I am Gabriel who stands in the very presence of God. And I have been sent to speak to you and to bring you this good news. And behold, you shall be struck dumb, silent, unable to speak until the day when these things take place, because you did not believe my words." So this is a perfect example of the leaven of the Sadducees, me putting my understanding above the word of God. This is Gabriel. This is an angel. He knew it was an angel. He's at the altar of the temple. And this is the exact answer to his prayer, even more of an answer than he expected. It's a huge privilege. It's the greatest human privilege up in that day. And he says, "I can't figure out how that's going to happen. I don't understand it." Well, he had 9 months and a few days to think about it. But that's the power of the leaven. The other leaven we see the power of in Acts chapter 10, when Peter is on the rooftop, getting toward lunchtime, he's hungry, he goes up there and has a vision. And the vision, I'm sure you know this passage well, a sheet comes out of heaven full with animals and creepy crawly things, and a voice out of heaven says, "Arise, Peter, and eat, kill and eat." And Peter says, "No, Lord." And it's a very emphatic no. It's not just, "No, I'd rather not, thank you." It's, "No way am I going to eat that." And he knew who spoke. He knew that voice. That he had heard that voice call his name many times before. He called him Lord. And he said, "I'm not going to eat any of those things." And he gives the reason. It's very clear. "Because I have never eaten anything holy and unclean. My religious teaching tells me not to do that. And I don't care, Jesus, if you spoke to me out of heaven, I'm not going to do it." The Lord brought that vision and that message three times before Peter obeyed. This is the power of the leaven, friends. We can have the angel Gabriel come to us and speak. We can have Jesus call to us from heaven, our risen and ascended Lord, and speak to us by name. And it will make no difference. We'll say no. "Someone else told me." So we made our obedience conditional on understanding, like Zacharias did. And this means that this is one of the areas of the fortress built out so we would not be able to exercise the authority of God, which is faith. That's how I define faith in one word. It's the authority of God. It's the authority to cast out demons, heal the sick, raise the dead, move mountains, open doors that are closed. It's the authority to have wisdom from God, to call into existence that which does not yet exist. It's the authority we need in order to teach the nations, which is why Jesus promised it to us at his ascension, just in the moment before his ascension. "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and disciple the nations, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you." Well, the enemy so taught us that now in our time, obedience is a dirty word. Authority is a dirty word, for that matter. We don't like either of those concepts. So we are completely confused when it comes to faith and the difference between hope and faith. We think we can feel faith, and we're tempted to wait for that feeling, even though we can't feel faith, and what we feel when we do feel something is hope. How do we get faith? Confusion. We have been taught wrongly. When I was a young YWAMer, I read every book we had about faith in our library, and we had a lot. Lauren had given his personal library to the base. Some years later, all those books were thrown out, of course. Lauren's handwritten notes on J.I. Packer's books. Don't cry, Steve. It's your birthday. They were recorded in heaven. You can read them later. So I got three partial answers about faith, and this just shows how teaching can stop the church in its tracks. We do not have the authority of Jesus. We're not using it. Why? Well, they tell us faith is a gift of God, which is true. These are partial truths. It's our interpretation that is wrong. But when they say that, it's like faith is a gift of God. You don't have much. Lauren Cunningham has a lot, and it's just arbitrary. And you were standing behind the door when the faith was passed out. So too bad for you, dude. That's how it comes across. I don't believe that. Another one is that faith comes by hearing, which is certainly true. It's a verse. But then we interpret that to mean if we hear a testimony and we have this feeling that means our faith is increased. And we hear this in YWAM meetings. Someone gives a great testimony. The leader comes up and says, "Wasn't that a great testimony?" "Yes." "Didn't that help your faith?" And I want to stand up and say, "No." It did not. When Cynthia would sit with me in these meetings, she'd immediately grab my arm. No, that feeling we feel with a great testimony is hope. Because hope comes through testimony. We read in the Epistle to the Hebrews, chapter 10, verse 23. Our testimony, the testimony we read or we hear, nourishes our hope. Hope is also nourished through prayer, because Paul prays for hope for the Romans in chapter 15, verse 13. Our hope comes through reading of the scripture, which he tells the Romans in chapter 15, verse 4. So hope has these three sources, but we want to apply them to faith. So we have an outreach team going out. Okay, everyone, let's gather around and pray that they would have faith. Nice idea, but totally useless. Waste of time. There is no answered prayer for faith in the New Testament. Hold fast the confession of your hope, Hebrews 10:23. We have hope through reading of the scriptures, Romans 15:4, and Paul's mighty magisterial prayer for hope in Romans 15:13 that we should all be praying every day for everyone we know, including for our nations. Romans 15:13. So, I realize I'm going through this quickly. So they tell us, well, we'll just pray for faith. Nobody prays for faith in the New Testament. Paul doesn't. He prays for everything else for his churches, as you know. Hope, wisdom, love, intelligence, never for faith. And I was on a 10-year search for how to know how to increase my faith. And I had no idea after 10 years, and the frustrating thing was my faith was increasing. The French ministry was growing. We were having fruit at Lausanne. And my faith was growing regularly, and I had no idea why or how. And I couldn't teach anyone else why or how, which is very frustrating for a teacher. So I'm reading the Gospels innocently again one morning, and I come to Luke 17, very well-known passage, where it says, the disciples say, "Lord, increase our faith." And I'm saying to the Lord, "Lord, there's got to be an answer in here somewhere, because for once these guys are asking the right question. They're not asking if they can call down fire. They're not asking who's going to be the greatest. They're not asking who can have the best seats. They're asking the right question, and they've realized they need more faith, and you know they need more faith, and you know just how much they're going to need more faith in the future. So your answer has got to be buried in here somewhere." And I try to get into this passage, and it says, verse 6 of Luke 17, "If you had faith like a mustard seed, you would say to this mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it would obey you." And I was unhappy with the Lord. I said, "Lord, this is not helpful, this mulberry tree in the sea business, because that's going to kill the mulberry tree. What is this about? Why don't you answer them?" And I had been misled. One of the reasons was the way my Presbyterian pastor preached this passage, but the other reason was that In many of our translation, there is a paragraph break between 6 and 7, verses 6 and 7. Now, the NIV got this right for once. The New American, it depends on the version. This one got it right. Others don't. But there should be no paragraph break between verses 6 and 7. If you got one in your Bible, color it in or something. Because he goes on, there's no reason to have a break there. That's the editors put it in. But there's no new group of people coming. They don't go anywhere else. They don't move. They're still standing there. And Jesus continues and he gives them the key in verses 7 through 10. And it's about the worker, the slave being out in the field. And the Lord says, you have to do everything I've commanded and keep on doing it, and don't even expect thanks for it. And your response should be, we are unworthy slaves. So I thought, what does that mean? And it hit me. He's saying, you want more faith? Keep on doing all that I have commanded you to do. If you're tired of it, keep on. If you're tired and hungry, keep on obeying. If you're the only one left out there, keep on obeying. But do all that I have commanded you, and your faith will grow. You will not be able to feel it. You will not know if you have a lot or a little, but keep on in the long obedience in the same direction, in the words of Eugene Peterson, and your faith will grow. And I said to the Lord, you mean faith comes from obedience? New thought. So I said, if this is true, it must be somewhere else in Scripture. Please show me, give me a confirmation. I can't preach this on the basis of one passage. And he led me immediately to Matthew 8. And this is the passage about, is it Matthew 8? Yeah. This is the passage about meeting the centurion outside of Caesarea. The centurion, the Roman officer, comes out to him and says, Lord, my servant is suffering at home. And Jesus said, okay, I'll come and heal him. But then the centurion says something that amazes Jesus. He says, Lord, I too am a man. I am unworthy for you to come under my roof, but just say the word and my servant will be healed. I too am a man under authority with soldiers under me, and I say to this one, go, and he goes into another, come, and he comes, and to my slave, do this, and he does it. And when Jesus heard this, he marveled. He marveled. He said, no one in Israel has such an understanding of faith. Not one. Actually, he said great faith, and that's the only time he uses this phrase. And as you know, the servant is healed. Jesus didn't even pray for him. Jesus didn't go there. He just said to the centurion, go your way as your faith is. Let it be done to you as you have believed. So what's going on here? The centurion we know is a convert, a Gentile convert to Judaism. Luke in the parallel passage says that he paid for the synagogue. So this is Pharisee country. He's been instructed by Pharisees. And what's their main topic of instruction? It's the Messiah. So they're telling him, the Messiah is going to come. It could be very soon now. Here's all the prophecies. He's been studying the prophecies. And then he starts to hear about Jesus. And he hears about this incredible authority that Jesus has, walking on the water, stilling the storm just offshore from Capernaum. This is before the feeding miracle, but he's been healing the sick, casting out demons. And the centurion concludes, this man has to be the Messiah. He's been hearing the Pharisees debate. No, no, it can't be him. He comes from Nazareth. No, no, it can't be him. He heals on a Sabbath. No, no, it can't be him. He hangs out with foreigners. So you're hearing all this religious stuff, but the centurion cares about one thing and one thing alone, and that is authority. Because he lives and dies by authority. If he does not have authority over his men, he risks his life every time they go out. And he risks his men's life. And he knows that he has authority over his men because he is under authority. So he concludes, the only way this Jesus could have that much authority is if he were under the authority of God, is if he were the one sent from heaven. So he said to Jesus, I too am a man under authority, and you don't have to come to my house. You have enough authority that my servant can be healed from here. And Jesus marveled. And in too many of our Bible translations, they take that word out. I too, or I also. They just delete it. In all the French translations, it's deleted. It's not a manuscript problem. It's in every manuscript. The translators just don't see that they should include that little word, which gives us the sense of the whole text. They decide this is not important. How do they decide that? Leaven. So the church loses its understanding of authority. And the key to authority, which is being under authority. And we make obedience something completely secondary, something optional. I'll do it if I understand it. And we wonder why we have so little faith. Then if we have understood the key to that, we need to really get serious about obeying what God tells us. Well, how do we obey? Well, the teaching we had in the 70s was you just choose. You choose to obey every day. That's the first point of your quiet time when you're sitting there, not moving, no music, early in the morning. Here are all the points you have to pray through every morning. The armor of God. So we were told to choose. And that worked most days until it didn't. And a lot of those early YWAMers tried to make it through on willpower, and it didn't work. They came to a day when they couldn't choose right, just by gritting their teeth. Turns out there's an easier way to the path of obedience, which the enemy has hidden from us again. And it's so clear in the writings of John that the key to obedience is love. The one who loves me is the one who does my commandments. The one who does my commandments is the one who, over and over, he says it again 20 times. Gold star. He restates it again in 1 John 5:3. And then he says, and his commandments are not burdensome. It's not hard to obey God if we love him enough. If we're finding obedience hard, maybe it's because we're waiting to figure it out. Don't wait. Maybe it's because we don't love him enough. But if we grow in our love for him, and worship is the key here, then the Holy Spirit sheds his love in our hearts. We express our love to him. The Holy Spirit glorifies him. And there's this cycle of love which makes obedience easy, and the next thing he says to do, we say yes, Lord, and we do it. Okay, now we're going to get into the Enlightenment some before we come to the good news. But that's part of the good news. All we need to do is love Jesus better, love him more every day, and things just simplify right out. The godfather of the Enlightenment was Descartes, mathematical genius whose theories are still used in game theory, devout Christian, was convinced he needed God for salvation in heaven, but not for any other reason on this earth. So he gave us three teachings. He was a 17th century guy, and there were other people who came close to this. I already mentioned that Abelard was one of the first to take us in this direction, lifting reason into first place. But Descartes crossed a line, some kind of line in the spirit. And Leslie Nibigan says, we fell. We fell further than we had in Eden. Because we made our mind, our thinking, our identity. I think, therefore I am. Being is defined in terms of thought. All knowledge starts with doubt. You doubt everything. You're skeptical of everything, and Descartes even doubted his own existence. How do I know I exist? Which I think is dumb. But he finally figured out, well, if I'm thinking, I must exist. Because only a Parisian could be comforted by that. So then all knowledge comes through reason, through my reasoning. I don't need God to discover anything. I just start with God, with doubt. I use my reason. And then it's this critical point of view, the subject-object split. I stand off from the object I want to figure out, and I judge it, whether it's true or not, using my reasoning. I said this in that think tank seminar I mentioned to you, and I got a couple strong reactions from a couple of people who said, we're not supposed to think that way, but that's the way we think. How are we supposed to think then? This is a very good question. And when I first came upon this subject-object thing, I thought, man, is there another way to think? I had the same reaction. That's how we do it. We have been taught to think in this way. The scripture tells us, love believes all things. We don't start with doubt. We start with belief. We believe in our brothers and sisters. It's a different beginning place, Bethan. Yeah, I know. It's when I, let me apply it to the Bible. Okay, the Reformation ended when Cartesian methods of analysis were imported into the Protestant seminaries of France and then Switzerland, three generations after the Reformation. So what they did with all ancient documents, including the Bible, including the dear Protestants, they subjected the Bible to their human analysis. We're going to figure out which parts of this are true. That's the object, and we're the subject who are going to decide if it's true or not, or which bits are true. That's the subject-object split as it applies to the Bible. But it's every area of science. So we're going to go through a few slides here, and you'll get these, so don't have to worry about writing everything down. We'll send them to you. Thanks to Lisa for all her help with this. So here's an example of the leaven in YWAM. What is missions? What does missions consist of? Good question if you're a missionary, right? Well, how many know this book, Transforming Mission by David Bosch? 2,000 years of church history. He goes through five major paradigms of missions, all of them very different, all of them coming from the culture around them. What is missions? Well, when I came into YWAM, we had one version of missions, and Lauren told us, our job as missionaries is to present the gospel personally to every creature. We usually included the body of Christ in that, but sometimes we forgot. Anyway, it's the individual presentation of the gospel to every human being. That was our job. That's missions. Remember this, Steve?
Not all the way back to 1960, but
I know, you're not as old as you look. Then we had a leadership conference in Kona, and we invited Peter Wagner. This is before... I won't say that. Anyway, he was into church planting. And he said, missions is planting churches. And he gave us a few scriptures. There weren't many, but we looked at those and said, okay, we'll plant churches. Because before we'd just been about individuals, see? And then we started planting churches. And you had to report from your YWAM bases how many churches you guys planted that year. Then we have this message out of Pasadena. First preached here in Lausanne, actually, at the Congress in 74, the Lausanne Congress. No, it's church planting among unreached people groups. It's real missions is unreached people groups. The church planting, you got to target the unreached people groups. And there was a whole thing about redeployment, and we were being told in YWAM, you got to redeploy. You got to take all of your missionaries out of these countries like Switzerland and America and send them to the unreached people groups. And we had YWAMers, young YWAMers, saying to their leaders, I think I'm called to Europe. And they said, nah, Europe's over with. Europe's had its chance. God's not going to give Europe another chance. You need to go to an unreached people group. Then another message from Pasadena. We were told the unreached people group has to be in the 1040 window. So we had all these churches saying to their missionaries, you got to move to the 1040 window. And if you don't, we're not going to support you anymore. Many YWAMers lost their support through this. And this is a teaching, friends. It's not in the Bible. You won't find 1040 windows in the Bible. Why did they even choose 1040? Some of us thought they should have chosen 550. It would have included a lot more unreached people groups. This was at the time when all the nation of Russia opened up to the gospel. We had open doors into every school in Russia, and Al Akimov could not convince any YWAM teams to come hardly because they were all trying to find unreached people groups. And we got thousands of schools in Russia open to the gospel. So he had a t-shirt printed up with a big square around the continent of the nation of Russia, was come to the window that's open. Unfortunately, he didn't sell many of those t-shirts. But why do we let other people define what missions is for us? There are five versions of the Great Commission in the four Gospels in the book of Acts, and hardly any, the only one that has to do with any of these is Mark 16:15. And then we have another grid, very useful. But we gotta now plant something in every one of those 4,000 and however many zones, because they change all the time. It's another grid. The grids are useful, but the grids are not our guidance, friends. They are teachings. They make great servants and terrible masters. And now we're trying to preach in the University of the Nations. Well, missions is really teaching the nations. And to do that, we have to do individual evangelism. We have to plant churches and all this other stuff. But does that sum up the total of what missions is? I don't think so. I don't think we know yet. I think we've got some things to learn about missions and God's heart for the nations. Yeah, so now we're told we need to face our fears. I remind David Hamilton of that very regularly. I'm sure he appreciates it. Okay, I'm going to go through this really quickly, but you're going to get the PowerPoint, and these points are explained in 80 pages of Bosch on how the Enlightenment influenced the church and missions. So if you want the detail and the names and the exact dates, it's all in here. Those 80 pages are worth the price of the book. The book is also in French, German, and Spanish. I don't know about, it must be in Portuguese. Yeah. I was going to say, if you just even buy this book and put it under your pillow at night, you will be so much smarter. Transforming Mission, David Bosch, South African theologian.
I know you have a lot to read, but even if you get it as a resource for the future, it's really worth it.
Yeah, I like the Enlightenment. Okay, here's one of the main teachings of the Enlightenment. Ultimate reality is matter in motion. Ultimate reality is matter in motion. Molecules, atoms, subatomic particles. We find more just down the road at the CERN reactor every month or so. What do Christians believe ultimate reality is? It's the Trinity, friends. And the loftiest human goal is the pursuit of happiness. All us Americans believe that because Thomas Jefferson taught us that. And understanding the world depends on the human mind. This is Descartes. Humans are autonomous. Lee, I'm not sure you're getting what I'm actually saying here. And there's a belief in progress. All problems are solvable. Let's just go to Geneva and sit down around a table and we'll figure out Syria. Knowledge is neutral, value-free, and factual. I was told in the 80s in my seminary, we started to have a discussion about abortion, which was kind of a taboo subject. And I got a little bit emotional. And I was told, well, we're not going to find the truth through emotional reactions, are we? And I was thinking, I didn't say it, but I'm thinking, if you think killing unborns is something to not get emotional about, maybe you haven't understood the problem. And certainty is attainable. We can get there. So there's naturalism. Everything has a natural cause. This is another way to say materialism. Rights count more than duty, because if humans are autonomous, it's our rights that are more important. It's not our duty to the group, to the community. There's categorization, which leads to specialization in the academy. The best illustration is medicine, where if you have a problem here, you go to that specialist. If you have a problem there, you go to that specialist. They never talk to each other, and nobody considers that you have a soul and a life and relationships that might be affecting your health. This is changing in medicine, of course. That's the good news. Morality becomes individual values. Here's something to think about. Values are the rubble left over when a structure of morality has already crumbled. Values are the bits of rubble left over when a structure of morality has crumbled to the ground. The nation state develops out of the Enlightenment. We think that technology is going to solve all our problems. Industrialization comes starting in the early 19th century. Urbanization. State-sponsored formal education as a means to social control and to train workers for the factories. The universe is a machine and God is an engineer. Christian organizations are machines, are factories, and the leader is the engineer. This was formally written about until about 1990. I'm a bit nervous about pressing this button. So, what about the effect on the church? Well, the church is always a product of the culture. What we believe has been taught to us by our culture in any time, any era. Reason is valued over revelation. The supernatural does not exist. Now, remember, we're talking about modernity here. Up until post-modernity, 1989, this was the church. Then there was a reaction against this, and we get postmodernity, which is not any better, because postmodernity goes straight back to the leaven of the Pharisees. There is nothing in postmodernity that we do not find here and in Jean-Jacques Rousseau. When the church discovered postmodernity a few years ago, I was reminded of the guy in Charles Dickens who was amazed and gratified to find out he'd been speaking prose all his life. But these guys decided, that's where we get the idea the supernatural does not exist. The Holy Spirit stopped working back then. Cessationist theology. You cannot be speaking in tongues because that doesn't exist. The fall went deeper into the mind. We mentioned this one already. There's a belief in the progress that in the church translated into postmillennialism and amillennialism, that the millennium is already here, we just didn't notice it. Well, that idea is not so popular now as it was. It's harder to believe that the millennial reign of God is already existing in the world as it is. Orthodoxy became defined as something that was intellectual. In other words, you're an Orthodox Christian if you believe a certain number of points of doctrine. You have a Christian worldview if you go through the list at the back of the book and tick off, yes, I believe that God is Trinitarian, that Jesus Christ is his incarnate son, and come to the bottom of the questionnaire, oh, I got them all right. I have a Christian worldview. No, you don't. You haven't the faintest idea. So the German theologians, in a noble attempt to grapple with Enlightenment thinking and to make the message of the gospel more reasonable to the culture, to the academic world, they came up with higher criticism, ways of interpreting the Bible that completely robbed it of its power, and even the idea that it was truth. They discipled the entire church because all over the world, including the U.S., if you were training pastors, you had to have at least one German theologian in your theological faculty. So we would send boatloads over. They would come huffing and puffing out of the Black Forest and get on boats and go to America. That's not my phrase. Someone else said that. And that's how we get this influence throughout the whole church. And even the fire-breathing Pentecostal denominations, they would import seminary teachers from those seminaries, and they would come and teach the stuff they normally taught, which was often extreme Calvinism. Hey, so many good things came out of Germany, like beer. You know, I find it interesting when nations back away from their call to disciple the nations, which they all have. So the French, instead of discipling the nations in how to live righteously and joyously before God, they make food an idol and they start the worldwide hotel restaurant industry. The Germans, when they backed away from it, they were still good at teaching nations how to brew beer. So our beer in America, Mexico, Togo, and Thailand all came from Germans setting up breweries there. But I believe that the European nations, especially Germany and France and England, their divine call is to disciple the nations. So when they withdrew from that call, they take that gift and they teach other things, colonialism and civilization, which drastically affected the missions movement. So Revelation is banned from the public square, from the university and the classroom. Schleiermacher at the University of Berlin made a noble attempt to keep theology in the university, but to do that he kind of had to circle the wagons and put it in a corner of the university, so that theology, instead of being the queen of the sciences as it was in the medieval university, in other words, theology was to be the integrator, the capstone of all the other sciences, it became a neglected corner of the university. In most hermeneutics, the Bible is subject to analysis, especially the higher criticism. My reason. Here's the subject-object split, which leads to the dichotomies of word and spirit, individual and church, faith and learning, religion and science, evangelism and social action, and the dichotomy between saying and doing. The church is separated off from all the other spheres, with the possible exception of, if you're a Christian, you could be a nurse or a primary school teacher, but... The church withdraws until the last generation. Christians were taught here in Switzerland not to vote, because that was participating in the world system. And of course, political career was out of the question. Journalism career was out of the question. So in the university of modernity, we are left with this: art divorced from beauty. The founder of our College of Humanities, Doug Fever, had been a professor of classics at Lehigh University, and he was in a faculty discussion and mentioned beauty, because Doug was a Greek scholar. he mentioned beauty and art, and the director of the art department, the dean, stood up and said to him, "Don't you ever mention beauty and art in the same sentence in front of me again." So we have music, not just punk rock, but classical, divorced from rhythm and melody. Architecture without human beings. Social sciences which destroy communities, like the anthropologists in the Amazon. Education which produces wounding and bondages instead of freedom and motivation. Economics without compassion, leading to slavery and poverty. Government which controls instead of serves, and period, and the nation states grow and multiply. And the state becomes our savior. That was the teaching of Hegel. Hegel was another step in the building out and building up of the fortress raised up against the knowledge of God. This is missions. How many have read Vishal's book on William Carey, Vishal Mangalwadi? Okay, that's even more urgent than this one. It's the story of the impact of the gospel through William Carey on India. And Vishal said this, "India is the largest democracy in the world because William Carey brought the whole gospel when he came to preach in India." And Carey taught on agriculture. He wrote down many of the languages right. He taught on women's rights. He worked to change the laws, many, many areas. And then Vishal goes on to say, "India is such an imperfect and corrupt democracy because the second wave of missionaries only brought the gospel of souls and churches and withdrew from all the areas of society." What if that second wave and the third wave and the fourth wave had continued the teaching of Carey? What would India be like today? So Christianized and mission-saturated nations such as Kenya are some of the most corrupt on earth. There's the most injustice in the world. Individualism marks missions and Christian NGOs. And the last commandment is all about plans, tables, statistics, and computers. I used to get the American Missionary Quarterly magazine. It's where missionaries talk to their boards. And one guy wrote an article, this is back when network computers are big. He said, "If only all the missionaries would network their computers, we could finish the Great Commission." God. Missions has become a series of problems we can solve. So David Bosch says, "The entire Western missionary movement of the past three centuries emerged from the matrix of the Enlightenment. We are prisoners in a prison whose bars we cannot see." Leslie Newbegin said, his book is Foolishness to the Greeks, by the way, it's all about the influence of the Enlightenment on the church, and he's quoted extensively by Bosch, "The greatest force for the secularization of the nations in the past two centuries was the Protestant missionary movement." You'll get the PowerPoint. Polanyi said, "The last three centuries have been the most brilliant in human history, but this light was created by burning the capital of 1,000 years of Christian tradition in the oxygen of Greek rationalism." Greek rationalism. We will not have more light by adding more oxygen. He said this back in the early 60s, I think, and it was after that that there was this, when people started to realize this, they reacted into postmodernity, which did not solve anything. Okay. So you're going to get the complete diagram of the leaven, the two leavens, and the slideshow. Now let's take 5 minutes for questions about this Enlightenment stuff. Yes, Susan.
Just very practically, you know, the need to know and understand before we act. I know I find myself many times in a quandary, what is God's will? What is God's will? What is God's will? I'm seeking to understand, and that creates so much stress rather than just, you know, enjoying God's presence every day. And I think that, if I could reflect, I think that is an impact of this. We need to know. We need to
Well, that temptation to know is, of course, the one that worked in Eden. You shall know. And so when the Enlightenment crystallized that in Greek form, but it's in other forms too. In the leaven of the Pharisees, you shall know is if you have experienced the supernatural. So it's not wrong to want to know the Lord's will and to seek it. What's wrong is to want to figure it out before you do it. And Lauren's secret is he never waits to figure it out. I know of two people on the planet like that. On the planet. I'm sure there are others. He gets something from the Lord. He asks for confirmation. He's always careful to ask for confirmation. Then he does it. That's his secret to growing this mission. It sounds so simple, but it's so hard to do. And of course, some of us have the gift of implicational thinking. And we want to think some more about the implications before we obey.
So why does it matter?
It matters because I don't think we'll understand more about missions until we go back to the one who sent us and until we go to it in the Word. And this is, it's like that worldview thing. I was vaccinated against the thinking of anthropology and philosophy because I had those in my university education before I got saved. So when I ran into this stuff in the church, I knew the harm it had done me. So when I ran into it in my Christian education, I thought, whoa, wait a minute. I don't want to learn about how to do missions from anthropologists. And missiology, as a science taught in our seminaries, comes directly from the anthropologists. Because after the war, when these young American soldiers who'd seen the world and wanted to go back and preach the gospel, they went to the theologians and said, we need you to tell us how to study missions. And the theologians said, we don't know anything about missions. Because they were blind to that in modernity, in the Reformation. Missions was not part of their thinking. So you could have a whole shelf of a systematic theology written by a theologian, which was supposed to be all areas of Christian thought and practice in the light of the Bible, and have one page on missions in the entire several-volume systematic theology. So they learn about missions from the anthropologists because they have an understanding of culture and cross-cultural communication. So they went to them to be taught. But they were not taught of God. And when I went to do my missions degree in 86, 87, we did not use the New Testament as a source of learning about missions. We had one course on the theology of missions, which included New Testament passages. But we learned about cross-cultural communication from anthropologists. And you can make a very strong case that the entire New Testament is all about cross-cultural communication. And there are keys there which we need. But we weren't even looking there. Why should we look there? That's our religious book. We'll do a devotional before class starts. But that can't be our textbook. This is an evangelical seminary.
Continue to do this, like basically we're just a bunch of humanists because we're defining our own reality. We're trying to.
Yep.
We're not succeeding, but we're trying.
Mm-hmm. And then we're always surprised when that doesn't work out too well. Is that the end here?
Yeah. Yes, it is.
Okay. I'm going to go on and go into the good news of how to get free from the leaven, okay? Because we want to be sure and cover that, and then we may well have some time for questions after. So when I started to work through this 30 years ago, and it hit me, the grip of the leaven and the grip of the leaven on me, and I started to see it in the church. And then I said, well, Lord, how do you get free? And he led me, first of all, to Matthew 16. And Peter's experience. So let's go back there to Matthew 16. Now, this is just after the second miracle. Just after they understood that they were to beware of the teaching. And so then he gives them a quiz there in the Jesus DTS. And he says, who do people say that the Son of Man is? And they said, well, some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets, or the first socialist, or a Jewish revolutionary, or an incarnation of Vishnu, or someone who went to study under a guru in India for 10 years, or an alien from another planet. Now, I added a few in there. This is what you read in our newspapers in some countries. Every Easter and Christmas, some professor publishes a book as he's finally figured out who Jesus is. And Jesus, according to his leaven, his teaching, his background, is either there's a rational explanation for Jesus, like the first socialist, like a Jewish revolutionary. Well, see, there were all these Jewish revolutionaries around at that time. The Romans hated them, and they were trying to put down these revolts, and Jesus was another one of those guys. Or they have a mystical explanation for Jesus, incarnation of Vishnu, whatever New Age idea you want to come up with. If we don't know who Jesus is, we will get an answer from our teaching, from our culture. And then he asked Peter, but who do you say that I am? And Peter says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus responds, if I may paraphrase, Peter, I know you're not smart enough to figure that out by yourself, and you're certainly not spiritual enough. You have a revelation straight from my Father in heaven. And I thought, that's it. That's the key. That's why the Lord has given us this teaching of how to hear the voice of God. Because in that moment of revelation, there is no leaven. And that's true. But it's only true as far as it goes, because as we read down in the same chapter, Jesus is trying to tell them that he's going to be arrested, tortured, crucified, put to death, and buried, but that he'll rise again on the third day. And Peter, feeling all spiritual, took him aside and began to rebuke him. Here's another example of the leaven being stronger than the word of God. Jesus is standing there telling him what's going to happen in person. This is Jesus, who he has just confessed as the Messiah. And he rebukes him and contradicts him. And Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are not setting your mind on God's interest, but man's. In other words, it's human teaching. It's the leaven of the Pharisees. The Messiah cannot be powerless. The Messiah will take power over all those Romans and Herod and everyone. So, thinking through the life of Peter, he's very close to Jesus. He's one of the closest. Betrays him, is restored publicly to leadership. He's there at Pentecost when the fire comes down, preaches, and 3,000 people get saved. has such a powerful anointing that when his shadow touches someone, they are healed. He's going around raising people from the dead. Has this experience that we already looked at in Acts chapter 10. But then, after the third vision, gets it, goes back to Jerusalem and tells the brethren that, yeah, he's understood now, and the message of Jesus, the love of God, is for all peoples, all the nations, not just for the Jews. So it seems like he's got it. But Paul writes in Galatians chapter 2 that he goes back into his leaven. There are people sent out from James who come to Galatia, and Peter, who had been fellowshipping with the believers, when these guys came out, he withdrew from fellowship and would not eat with them and would not go into their houses anymore. It's the grip of the leaven. And this is the bad news, is that experiences with God will not by themselves set you free. Even supernatural experiences, even amazing, awesome supernatural experiences like raising people from the dead will not change your thinking. Now, they will help your hope. They will give you a larger picture of God. They'll be a manifestation of God around you. They're good things, but in themselves, they will not set us free. Well, who got more free from the leaven than anyone else that we know of? It was Paul. Paul, who had not experienced Jesus when Jesus was here on earth, who had not walked with him for 3 years like Peter had, not been there at the tomb, not been there at Pentecost. But Paul saw Jesus. And he gives us these portrayals of Jesus that are written like hymns sometimes in Colossians and Philippians 2. He understands Jesus. He understands his... Let me just read that passage. I know you know it well, but the one that Thomas Cahill calls the most beautiful Greek ever written. Apparently it rhymes in Greek. It's the Kenosis passage. It's a hymn sung as a hymn by the early church. Philippians 2 from verse 5. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance of a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore also God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. He sums up the whole existence of Jesus in heaven, the emptying, the incarnation, the crucifixion, his exaltation, all in those few verses. He had seen Jesus. And he had seen the message of the gospel more clearly than anyone else. He knew that it was not the Pharisee version where you had to become as a Hebrew and do all the stuff, be circumcised, observe the dietary laws, the Sabbath laws, all that. He knew that was not the message. That was so full of leaven. How did he get free? I think it's that day on the road to Damascus where he was knocked off his horse by a flash of light, heard the voice from heaven, was struck blind, led off to that room where no one wanted to talk to him for 3 days. And he was alone with himself and his thoughts. He does not actually tell us what he was thinking, but I believe it had to be somewhere along the lines of how did I get everything so wrong? How could I have missed the Messiah so completely for such a long time? He was in my country. I heard the things he was doing. I thought I knew what he would be like. I knew all the prophecies. How could I have missed him? And he had to realize at some point that all that he had learned, it was not wrong, it was not false, because it was Bible, but the interpretation of it was either wrong or incomplete. And of course, that first revelation of the Messiah being the one with power and authority, that was right, that was correct. But that he would come, first of all, in weakness to die and give his life, and then again come in glory later, that was the incompleteness of their revelation. So, I believe that Paul had a period of time. It may have been his time in the Arabian desert, but we do know that he was apparently, he didn't have responsibilities of the church in Jerusalem like Peter did. He didn't seem like he was married, although some theologians have said in earlier times that the thorn in his flesh was a wife. Those guys, I'd like to check out their marriages, as well as their relationships to their fathers. Anyway, so he had this freedom. He was traveling, and I believe he did quite literally what he wrote to the Corinthians. He took every thought captive. Every thought captive. And he examined every teaching. First of all, the ones about the Messiah, certainly. And then the ones about how to live a life consecrated to God. And he did a rigorous mental exercise of taking them captive. And I do a visual with this. I get a thought in my mind, something I should do or some teaching, and I visualize myself gripping that thought around the throat and saying, thought, I am not going to let you go until you tell me where you came from. And I've been doing that for 30 years, and it's amazing how much nonsense we believe that has no biblical basis whatever. Here's an example. I was noticing reading Formes a few years ago that a lot of our DTSs were having a week of teaching on balance. Balance. And a major YWAM leader at a conference I was at said, truth is the point where the pendulum stops and it comes to motionless, and that truth is the dead point at which the pendulum stops swinging. I thought, that is the worst definition of truth I have ever heard. Whatever truth is, it is not a dead point. But we had this teaching that you had to be balanced. And wrong thinking was defined at being on one extreme or the other. Well, this is how culture defines truth. It's whatsoever in the middle. And there's two extremes out there, but truth is what's in the middle. So the guy who's giving the news is always the balanced one. Right? Here's how it was in the abortion debate in America a few years ago. Okay, these people say abortion should be permitted all the time, anytime. These people say it should never be permitted for any reasons. They're both obviously extremes. They're both therefore wrong. So the balanced opinion is, yes, we can have abortion, we should, but under these circumstances. That's how the abortion debate has gone in many nations. And if you get to define the extremes, you get to define who's got the truth, because they're in the middle. If you get to define who's in the middle, then you define who's extreme and loony and should not be listened to. And maybe locked up. So this is starting to annoy me. So I'm starting to think, where in the world does this teaching about balance come from? Because I'm running through the Bible in my mind, and there is no man or woman of God in the Bible or in the history of the church that I can think of, whoever advanced the kingdom, who is considered to be balanced. They were all considered to be weird. Where does it come from? It comes from the Greeks. It's a Greek ideal of living your life according to balance, equilibrium. It was re-imported into Europe in the 18th century. There's a whole room about it in our national university down by Neil. The Enlightenment ideal of balance. And we imported it uncritically into the church. There's even a verse in Ecclesiastes 7 in the NIV where they bring balance in, which is not there in the other translations. Here's the good news. You are unbalanced. Many of your family and friends think you're weird for being in YWAM. You mean they don't give you a salary? You have to pay your own plane tickets? What's wrong with you? You are totally unbalanced. Jesus did not call us to live lives of equilibrium and balance. He called us to take up our cross daily. And if our lives look balanced to those around us completely, we are probably not taking up our cross. Now, as missionaries, we have to disguise ourselves to live normally. So I have geraniums by my front door. Talk to my neighbors about the weather. I can do that. I'm a missionary. But in my heart, I am very strange. I am committed to radical obedience. Question here.
Yeah, no, I was just wondering, would the balance thing be something that is kind of born out of because there are no absolute values, like because of the light or other things, because you don't... our values is based on what we think is right and wrong, so balance becomes the mechanism to kind of help that there's no absolute truth.
Yeah, that's very possible. That's a good point. But then the definition of what's extreme changes all the time. Now let's go to the other part of Paul's answer, which lines up with taking every thought captive, and that's Philippians 3. And this follows that magnificent hymn we just read. And he starts off Philippians 3 with another warning against the Hebraizers. I used to kind of get tired of these. I said, what are you writing about this in every single letter, all these churches? Write about something else, you know. But I finally figured out that it was absolutely crucial what he was doing. And this was not just for those people facing that problem back then. This is for us. This is our leaven. This religious teaching that we think we need to do these things to please God and not do those things because those things don't please God, and we get that idea from our surrounding culture. We do not get it from the Bible. Because what Paul is communicating in that passage we read in Philippians 2, this is my interpretation, God doesn't care. He doesn't care what we eat or don't eat. He doesn't care how we dress. He doesn't care what we drink or don't drink. He doesn't care when we worship, when we have our quiet time, when we have our Sabbath. He doesn't care. We should not care. If our brother is doing it different from us, now we should have our Sabbath. We should have our times with God. Of course we should. But to limit it and argue over it and define it down and say, if you don't do this, you're not spiritual, that's Phariseeism. Let's care about what God cares about. And religious activity is apparently one thing he cares very little about. So, in Philippians 3, as you know, he goes through and names all his identities. He names the sources of his teaching, the forces that have molded his identity. And they're the same for all of us. He names his tribe, his group, his religious obedience, all these things. And he identifies, and I believe he does this, because he has examined every teaching that he has ever received from all these sources. And over years, he has taken every thought captive, and he's taken every teaching, and he said, who told you? Who told you this, to tell me this, how I should live my life? Who I am? What I should act like? Who I should hang out with? Who I should spurn and reject? Who told you? So this is what I propose for your homework for the next 40 years, give or take. You do a list. Who do people say that you are? When you fill out a form for a job, for the government, any form, who do they say that you are? What is your family name? What is your gender? What generation are you a part of? What is your educational level? What is your religious background? What is your level of zeal? Faith missionary, whoa, that's a really good. What is your professional experience or job experience?
Marital status.
Oh, thank you, that's very important. It really hit me that I was, when I changed my Facebook status to single, man, I had no idea that would have such an effect on me. But I was a different person. And you're defined differently as a single, aren't we? Okay, we now have music. I remember the day I came out of the closet about my country music. Yeah, I'm adding some of these categories that Paul didn't have, but you can add all that are important to you. And of course, we need to put in, I skipped over your nationality. There's language. In Switzerland, we have 4 official languages, and we talk to each other in English. So that's very important. And then in, it's not just nation, it's also region or canton or state. For example, Patty Lee is from Texas. That is totally different, that place. In the church, we define ourselves by our ministry. So, this is who people say that you are. These are your identities. These things have shaped you, these forces. Military service we could put in there. So then our job is to start counting. Okay, who taught you to teach me what? And to take those thoughts captive. And it is, I believe, this discipline which can set us free from the leaven. It's not going to happen in one miraculous prayer. That would be nice. But it goes along with what we've been saying. This is another way to say you put off the old man and put on the new. This is part of the putting off. Every teaching we have ever heard, who taught you? Who? Where do I get that? Why am I so convinced that I react in anger against my brother or sister? Where did it come from? Did I learn that from Jesus? Is it in the book? And we put on the new. I have tried to enter into the discipline of 1 Corinthians 13, and I've still got a long way to go there. I want to believe all things of my brothers and sisters. I want to assume the best in every situation, in every email I receive. And that's part of putting on the new, trying to think according to the principles of Philippians 4:8. whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, if there is any excellence and anything worthy of praise, let your mind dwell on these things. That's where our mind should be. Not full of doubt and judgment, figuring out who's right, who's wrong. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word, which contains all that we need, which can help us replace our wrong filters with filters that will help us to see light. I pray that you'd give each and every one of us a growing realization of the grip of the leaven upon us, but also the hope, according to your word, that if we continue in your word, we will be your disciples, and we shall know the truth, and the truth will set us free. In your light, we see light. And we thank you that you lead us on that path to dwell in light with you. Amen.